podcast or interview in a very long time.
For sure.
So I'm sitting down today with Georgia Monroe from Basecamp Farms, and we are at a beautiful location at their flower farm and flower shop, and I am so excited to talk to you today. So, for those of you who maybe do not know about Basecamp Farms, maybe you could kind of tell us a little bit about what you guys do here.
Absolutely. So, yeah, my name is Georgia Monroe, and I'm with Basecamp Farms. So, we are located just outside of College Station, and so we grow cut flowers for the floral industry. And so, we are just in our fourth season. We're going into our fourth season, and so we are very new. I do not have a horticulture background. I went to school to be a nurse, and so I have been self-taught, and so we have kind of started from the ground up. It's been a labor of love, and we have, starting this year, about 7 acres, 8 acres in production, and so we've expanded very quickly. The first year we had about 0.5 acre in production, and the second year it was about, I think, 1 acre. And then it's just kind of kept going up after that. Yeah.
So yeah, you guys have grown rapidly and expanded very quickly. I looked through y'all's story and your background and everything, and you come from kind of a farming, ranching background.
That's right. Yeah, I'm a fifth generation farmer. And so my family got started mostly with cotton. Okay. So we have cotton and wheat, and that's back in West Texas.
Okay.
And so my family's all in West Texas. And so we, cotton, wheat, my grandfather was a cotton gin manager for 30 years. And then my dad, he was a banker for his full-time job, but we had a hobby ranch. And so he roped cattle and steer wrestled, and he actually went to Texas A&M, and he was on the rodeo team and the meat science judging team. And so I grew up on a small ranch and grew up around team roping, and I showed lambs with the 4-H and FFA. I did animal judging as well in junior high and high school. And so I very much came from a agriculture background. My husband did not.
Okay.
He is from urban Southern California.
Okay.
And so this has been a learning experience for him, but for both of us as well.
Yeah. Well, how cool that you guys kind of get to do it together. And obviously, I mean, you can't see obviously on the camera right now, but this is something to be proud of for sure.
Thank you.
So what, all of that as your background, what made you decide floral and flowers?
Yes. So I'm a crazy plant lady. That's where it starts. And I'm hard-headed as well. And so I've always loved flowers, and my phone has over 40,000 pictures of flowers. So growing up, I always enjoyed flowers, and my parents, they did it all themselves, like landscaped gardens in their backyards. My parents also had like an acre vegetable garden, and so they shared it with everyone in the community and at church. And so I didn't appreciate it then like I do now, because I know how much hard work it is.
Yes.
And so they instilled that love for me. And so as I got older, I went to nursing school and worked as a nurse for about 1.5 years. My husband was in the Army and stationed at Fort Hood. And so while he was in the Army, he was gone. He was gone for over 2 years of our, well, no, he was gone over half of the first 2 years of our marriage. And so he's gone a lot. So while he was gone, I tried to be productive and started to just learn about gardening in general. And so that's kind of where it started. And over there, we've been married now 10 years. And so over the first few years of our marriage, we bought 2 houses, and I had the opportunity to do the landscaping. And so the first house was a new build. And so I was able to do all the landscaping myself for that one. And my parents were really big on like native Texas landscaping plants, low water, not necessarily the xeriscape deserty plants, but just beautiful flowering plants that were appealing to all of the pollinators and that helped the pollinators. And so that's what I wanted in my gardens as well. And so the first house was a new build. The second house was whenever we moved back to College Station for my husband's job. And the previous owner did everything wrong. And so I tore it all out over the course of about 1 year. And we really, I got to start over on that property. I've always really enjoyed it. And so while we were in that College Station house, back up a few years, I just started learning about the floral industry. I wanted to have cut flowers. I wanted to have bouquets in my home, but I wasn't happy with what the grocery store options were.
Right.
And I wasn't happy with those options, and then I couldn't afford, you know, buying them every week like
right.
I wanted. And so I started learning about the flower industry and where flowers come from. And so currently about 70 to 90% of flowers in the United States are imports.
Okay.
And so they come from all over the world.
Huh.
Primarily for us, it's South America. And so Ecuador, Colombia, Mexico, Holland is a big one, Italy, China, and Kenya are also other big ones. And so that started back in the 60s, 70s, 80s, early 90s. You know, wealthy Americans went down to those countries and made million-dollar greenhouses. And that's, you know, the labor is cheaper, the
right.
land is cheaper. There's, I don't know if there's any taxes. If not, it's very,
yeah.
very minimal. And so they're all imported in. And so that's why the flowers that you see at the grocery store, those, they may not last for very long. Whenever they get to your end user, and that's because they've been either in storage for those roses can be cut anywhere from 7 days up to 30 days.
Oh, wow.
And they can be stored in coolers for up to that long. So Valentine's Day is coming up, and already the floral industry is preparing for that one holiday, and I can guarantee you that even flower shops in College Station have like refrigerated trucks already full of flowers, you know, up to 10 days to 2 weeks in advance. So that's why they don't last for very long,
huh.
is because they've maxed out. They've lived their life in storage.
Right.
So, yeah. So the flowers that you see at the grocery store or flower shops, like they come from all over the world. And so I started just learning about where those flowers come from, and that's kind of where our niche is right now, is that we're able to grow flowers that don't ship well. So all of those flowers that are imported are shipped in cardboard boxes, 3 foot by 1 foot wide, and you know, they're out of water, and so that's very stressful on that plant. And so at a regional level, there are hundreds of flower varieties that do great. They just can't be shipped like that.
Okay.
And so that's what we try to focus on.
Okay.
And so that can range. We grow 12 months out of the year. And so we grow about 40 different flower varieties
right.
over that 12 month span. And some of them, we have our main crops. So sunflowers are our main crop. I'm hoping to grow like 400,000 of them this year. So it's a big number. And so that's our main focus crop. Sunflowers are not my favorite flower. Most people think that they are, but that's not right. Dahlias and garden roses are my favorites, actually. So sunflowers, they grow really well here. And so here in South Texas, we're very limited on what does well.
Right.
Unfortunately, we have a very harsh growing environment. It's extremely hot. It's extremely humid where we are.
Mm-hmm.
And so what is today? January 25th?
Yep.
And it's 75 degrees
yes.
here. And so our cool season crops, they need to have about a 50 to 55 soil temperature to do well. And so where we are today, you know, that's just very hot.
Right.
And so a lot of those cool season flowers will go dormant if the soil temperature is that high for very long.
Right.
So it's constant up and downs with those temperature swings. In the summertime, we get hurricanes
mm-hmm.
and wind storms, and so that's very damaging as well. We have our average frost date, and so for us, that is around Thanksgiving, which is November 27th, 28th. But the last 2 years, we've had early frost, up to 4 weeks. Last year, it was 4 weeks early. And so that, we lost 10,000 plants in that night. So it is very harsh where we live. I mean, it's 75 degrees in January. That's pretty nice.
Right.
So there's pros and cons. But it's pretty similar, I would say, to growing or living like in Phoenix or even South Florida. It's very similar to that. So we grow warm season and cold season plants. So cold season, we have, which is where we are now, we have Icelandic poppies, ranunculus, anemones, stock snapdragons, dianthus, daffodils. We're not really able to grow tulips very well here because our soil temperature is too high.
Gotcha.
And I planted 1,000 of them last year and failed miserably
because
it was just way too warm. And so daffodils are a little bit easier. They don't care quite as much. Dahlias, we do winter crops of dahlias, sweet peas. That's the majority of our crops right now. And then summertime, we do about 8 different colors of sunflowers.
Okay.
So those are super fun.
Yeah.
So we do the classic yellow with a dark center, and then there's a yellow with a green center, and then there's a white one. It's actually a pale, pale yellow, like almost a buttery, but it fades to white.
Nice.
And so there's white ones, there's a plum one. We're in Texas A&M country, so we grow a burgundy sunflower for the Aggies.
Dig them.
Lots of maroon and white. We try to do lots of maroon and white in all of our flowers just because of that reason.
Right.
And it's really hard. It's really hard to find the right maroon flower.
Yes.
And some people are really picky about
it. I was
going
to say, trying to find those people that it has to be the right shade of maroon. It must
it
be
can't
difficult.
Be too red. It can't be too purple. So it's pretty tricky. Let's see. So then we do zinnias and cosmos, marigolds, lots of celosia. This coming year, we're doing really big on celosia because they dry really well. And so that's something we're also exploring is drying flowers. So that way we have minimal waste. You know, if flowers don't sell, we can dry them. And it's also very trendy right now with, you know, and then some people are more, they want to buy the dried product just because it lasts longer. Like some people don't like fresh flowers because they don't last for very long. And so drying them kind of gives us a different channel for income stream.
Yeah, absolutely.
Which is nice.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Speaking of income stream too, I mean,
yeah.
You guys can't tell, but we're sitting at their facility where they have a flower shop, this gorgeous pergola thing that we're sitting under. They have their greenhouses back there. What are some of y'all's other income streams besides obviously selling the flowers?
We have a lot.
Yes.
We are very busy here. So we have about 6 or 7. So we do wholesale. So we sell to a distributor in Houston, our sunflowers especially. We also do local regional florists. So we sell to them as well. They either come to our farm or they... we deliver. So we do
gotcha.
delivery routes within about a 60-mile radius is what we normally do. We also do bouquet orders, and so that's something new that we added in 2020, especially with the pandemic. The floral industry really shut down during the pandemic.
Yeah, sure, that was...
And so we had to switch gears fast because last March and April, we had 1.5 acres of flowers blooming and we needed to sell them quickly. And so we started doing more retail direct to consumer. And that was huge for us.
Mm-hmm.
And so we started doing, we actually added in a little flower shop, an on the farm flower shop. So people could go through our website and order bouquets and vase arrangements easily. And so that was huge for us. We also added on the farm events. And so one of those was called Pick Your Own. And people can go through our website and during select days and times during the year, especially during the warm season.
Right.
So that would be April to November to Halloween.
Yeah.
October is kind of our ideal time frame when our fields are full and they're very colorful. And so pick your own, people can come out, buy a bucket or a jar, and they can harvest from our fields.
Okay.
And so that's really fun.
Yeah.
And that is really easy on me because flowers are a perishable product.
Right.
And so without us having to get really big and get, you know, very logistical with how we sell our flowers, the pick your own has been a lifesaver for us, especially during the pandemic times, because people cut the flowers and, you know, I don't have to worry about them dying before their lifespan is up. So we also have 20 chickens on the farm, and so the kids come, well, kids and adults come and feed the chickens, and so that's been really fun. And that's kind of our vision moving forward, is becoming a destination kind of location and letting everyone come to the farm and experience being outside and what we do here. And, you know, when I was going to school 15 years ago, I wasn't aware of all of the different job opportunities in agriculture, right, and horticulture, for sure. And so, you know, I want to give everyone, but specifically kids, just kind of that eye-opening experience to do what we do.
Yeah, kind of the ag tourism side of things too, mm-hmm, just kind of exposing people who would not otherwise be exposed to agriculture in a fun kind of community way.
So for sure. Cool. For sure. Yeah, and flowers, they are one of the highest per acre crops that you can have. And I think that's, nobody knows that.
Yeah.
You know, the floral industry is like a $5 billion industry.
Well, yeah, I can only
and
imagine with
everyone,
and everything, right?
Yes. Oh yeah. And so it's huge. And then there's always weddings.
Yep.
There's always weddings. There's always funerals. There's always birthdays and anniversaries. And so there's tons of opportunity there.
Yeah.
That we're wanting to share.
Yeah.
So, yeah. So then we do, we have this event center. We built this pavilion we finished it about a year ago. And so we've been renting it out for small events. And so 100 people or less. We have big dreams for it to do bridal showers, baby showers, corporate parties. I host workshops myself. And so we do Christmas wreath workshops, gardening workshops, floral design, watercolors, you know, you name it, we do it. We really want to, I've started doing, you know, college parties as well, or sorority events.
Yeah.
I hope to do like field dinners, and having concerts out here, music nights,
cool. Yeah.
Even kind of doing like markets. We have some events in the works of doing kind of like market, kind of events,
yeah,
with other vendors, pizza oven and wineries and breweries. So it's going to be really fun.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's such a beautiful place. I mean, we're really not that far from College Station, Bryan area, but yet it's kind of like its own little slice of heaven out here.
That's right. And we are also an hour and a half from Houston,
right,
and we have tons of customers that come up almost every week to come and either buy flowers, or we also do photography sessions,
right,
out here.
That was one other thing I wanted to,
yeah,
mention.
Yeah, so photography sessions have been huge for us. And so people can go through our website and they either, we offer floral photography sessions. So that's blue bonnets, wildflowers. This year we're experimenting with a larkspur field. I'm not sure yet if it's gonna work, but larkspur is about a 3 foot tall, kind of English style garden flower. It's one of my favorites, so I'm hoping it works. But we had a very warm, dry fall, so I don't know that we're gonna get good germination on it. But, and then we also do sunflowers. So I think we offer sunflower sessions differently from other ag tourism farms, in that it's private. And so a photographer can, you know, bring one family or do mini sessions out here, and you're not fighting,
right,
for the best shot. I think at some of the other ag farms nearby, you know, there's 1,000 people,
right,
running around and kids,
yeah,
are running around. So we only want small groups, and they pay a rental fee, and either myself or a team member gets them checked in, and we have quite the process now, but that's really, really popular for us as well.
Yeah, I'm sure. Yeah. Well, and if those who don't know how popular blue bonnets and sunflowers and all that is in Texas, if you're looking in here at this area, here you go. You found your own little honey hole.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. So yeah, I think that's the highlights of our income stream. We are hoping to start shipping as well. We're doing some experimenting with shipping and nationwide in the lower 48. So that'll be really exciting as well. But most of our flowers we want to keep local.
Right.
And yeah, just trying to be as diverse as possible. I think especially with 2020 and seeing how other flower farms, especially the big ones in California and really on both coasts, struggled.
Mm-hmm.
We were small enough that we could pivot easily and,
right,
and have, I think it's wise to have multiple income streams just because you never know what's gonna happen in the future.
Absolutely, if 2020
yeah.
taught us anything, right?
Just
to
right.
kind of be diverse and
yes.
creative as well.
Yeah.
Yeah, and so also when I first got here, she was kind of giving me a quick tour and rundown of the place. And you mentioned that you guys start pretty much every flower as a seed and then transplant it into your fields. So could you kind of maybe walk us through that process a little bit?
Sure. So yeah, probably about 75% of the majority of our flowers we do from seed. So we do have a propagation greenhouse, and so we start everything by hand. The only two that we actually direct seed in the fields are sunflowers and larkspur. But we do either trays, so we do like 128s or 72 trays. I should have brought one over. but we do trays and then we hand plant. So the planting and the harvesting is all done by hand. And weeding too. We actually have to stay on top of the weeds. And so all of that, yeah, so it's a labor of love. And so I, myself and a team member, we try to stay on top of the seeding schedule every week. We try to just, we have our whole little schedule and we get after it. We do use a paper pot transplanter. We're doing some experimenting with that it's a Japanese made product mostly for vegetable farmers. But more and more flower farmers are doing some experimenting. It doesn't work on all of our flower varieties, but for, I would say, half of them, it does work really well, which cuts our labor significantly. And so that's kind of the goal, right? Is to cut those labor costs. So yeah, and then we do bulbs. So daffodils, ranunculus, and anemones, butterfly ranunculus, and then dahlias, those come as tubers. And so tubers or corms or bulbs. And so those we actually hand plant out. And then for some of our flowers, we actually order them in. Okay. So we actually buy from other nurseries up in the north part of the country. And like they have state of the art facilities. And I think a lot of it is done by computers and robots. Mm-hmm. But they get, because we're so hot, because we're so hot here, and it's hot until our first frost, and then maybe even then some, to get a jump start on our winter crops. The winter crops really need to have like 50 to 70 degree soil temperatures, which we never get, or it's way too late. Mm-hmm. And so for those flower varieties, we order those in. And so that way, I know it's just insurance for me. I know I'm gonna have a successful crop.
Exactly.
There's less time wasted. And then if I have bad germination, you know, I have the insurance of that. Those plugs coming, they're called plugs. And so usually they get a much better germination rate than I ever would, and they guarantee them. So there's lots of pros to doing that. We did do some experimenting with some of our, you know, doing both, like for snapdragons, for example, and lisianthus, they take forever to grow, to be big enough to be field size ready. And so like lisianthus takes 7 months from seed to harvest, and they have to be in your greenhouse for 4 months, and so it's just not worth it.
Right.
It's not cost effective to do it that way. So we've learned a lot. We keep learning a lot every year, and we're improving the processes on what works for us. And Texas is so big. Like what I do is different from what a buddy does in Austin or in Tyler or Dallas. Like it's totally different based on our microclimates and how we grow here. So it really just depends.
So being in Texas, it's hot. We've touched on the weather aspect of everything. Are there some processes that you guys have to kind of alleviate some of those challenges, or is it kind of just figuring out which ones work best with those climate challenges?
Yeah, it's really just what works best for us. And, you know, every year, I mean, it changes every year. It's based on the storms and the temperatures. And so because we can, for example, we can grow year round here, like during the winter time, whenever we have a cold front come in, if it gets below, we'll say 35 degrees, we use frostbath to cover what we can of our plants. But with that, it's extremely expensive.
Right.
And so not only do you have to have the frost cloth, but the frost cloth has to be on either T-post or little hoops to keep it off of your plants. And so anyways, it's just very expensive to do that. So every year we order more to build up our collection, but there's no way I could cover 5 acres in frost cloth. Yeah. And so there's stuff like that. You know, ideally, anytime that we can grow under a tunnel, correct. And so that's also a very expensive investment. And so over time, you know, my goal was to put in 2 unheated tunnels every year, which are kind of the least expensive options, just so that way we can start improving our products, and that just opens up doors for us. So yeah, so typically where we are, we don't have to heat our tunnels. We don't get that cold. Like, there may be 5 nights where we have to heat our tunnels, and so it's not bad. It's really not bad. You know, those 5 nights are very long and no fun, but it's manageable and survivable. In the summertime, you know, I'm always watching out for the thunderstorms and windstorms. You know, we've had several windstorms where we had 70-80 mile per hour winds, mm-hmm. and it knocked over my sunflowers, and that just stinks. There's really nothing that we can do about it, so it just happens. And then hurricanes are kind of the same way. It's just part of farming, and I think every location has its challenges. Absolutely. Whatever that may be.
Absolutely. So, well, too, on the flip side of that, humidity wise, greenhouses, right? You're typically thinking greenhouses help with humidity or maintain the humidity for growth. How is that different because we have plenty of humidity?
We have more fungus.
Okay, that's what I figured.
Yeah, we have more fungus here with our higher humidity. And so there's a couple of ways that we can combat that. We try to do a little bit further spacing to give it better airflow on the plants. Depending on the crop, we may go through and take off the infected leaves. And then we also do fungicide sprays as needed. Depending on the flower variety and the time of the year, we may or may not do that prophylactically. So it just kind of depends on where we are. We try to be minimal. We are not organic, but we try to be minimal and responsible as possible. If we do have to spray anything, we do it very early in the morning before the pollinators come out, usually in the dark. And so we try to manage those chemical sprays as best as we can. So just kind of, it all depends. There's really no black and white. There's a whole lot of gray. And it's all science. Like, I feel like this is all just a big science project. Never ending science project.
Measure here, cut there, what fix, what stuff.
Yes. And even every day, like, I have a team. I don't know if we talked about that.
No, that was actually gonna be my next question.
I have a team now. I have a wonderful team. And so typically on any given day, it's kind of our slow season right now, but we have 3 to 5 consistent team members right now. And I had to add, I mean, really, it's just over, I would say, half an acre. You really need to have more help with flower farming, whether that's whatever task you don't like. I would probably delegate that first. And so my first one was to hire a bookkeeper, and then I hired, you know, a college student to help me wash buckets. And so now I have 3 employees. My third one just started not too long ago, but they do about 30 hours of work a week. And then I have several other kind of seasonal college students and high school students who help me with weeding and making bouquets. And I have a girl that helps me with my office work, and so doing emails and my website upkeep, my inventory. She helps me with all of that, and she's a stay-at-home mom, and so she does 10 to 15 hours a week. So not much, but, you know, my team right now puts in anywhere between 100 and 140 hours, so it's just significant. And then as our growing season goes on, we'll add more seasonal help, just to get us through the growing season. And so there's just a lot of moving parts, and I spend probably 30 minutes to an hour every day kind of updating the task list for our team. And, you know, every day, like, the tasks may change based on the weather and what the humidity is and what the forecast says. Like, if we have a cold front coming through, we may hold off on planting for the week. So it really just depends. But there's no way in the world I could do it without my team now. And so they're huge for our operation.
And you mentioned kind of earlier too that you came into the floral industry and kind of didn't realize that it was, you know, so huge and so much room for opportunity. What's maybe something you would tell somebody who's thinking about it or just trying to get into it?
Study as much as you can. I would say if you can go work for a farm, whether that's a flower farmer or a vegetable farmer, or even a cattle operation, go work for someone at, I would say, a year, 6 months to a year. But if you do a year, you can really see the seasons.
Right.
And I think that would be huge, especially before you make that step to become a business. Flower farming, and I'm sure it's with this with cattle operations too, there's just a high cost of entry. It's huge and it's scary. And so I did not really like fully understand, I did not do a business plan. And so I would highly recommend doing a business plan now, but like really understanding what those expenses are. And some of them are very obvious and then some of them are hidden as
right.
well. And so really, you know, spending time and going and interviewing other farmers in your state and even the country. Mm-hmm. There are plenty of courses now online, and if you need recommendations, let me know. I have my personal favorites that I won't share on camera.
Yeah, but no, keep them a hidden secret.
Yeah, well, some of them are just better than others. And I think, you know, some of those classes, like if you can find someone kind of similar growing climates, you know, if you live in the Pacific Northwest, that's hugely different than
exactly.
growing in South Texas.
Exactly.
So it just kind of depends on where you are. There is a vegetable farmer in Canada, and I really wish I would have taken his class because he has like the business side down.
Gotcha.
And so I think with flower farmers especially, we tend to get lost in the beauty of the flowers, mm-hmm. and we don't treat, you know, you don't really think about the business side. And growing the flowers is the easy part, but selling the flowers is the hard part.
Yeah.
It really is. And especially with a perishable product, it's hard. It's really hard. And so having that understanding, you know, what your sales channels are, and those take years to develop. I felt like my business model has changed every year that we've been in business.
Yeah.
And partly that's just how we've grown, and then partly that was the pandemic,
yeah.
and so external factors that
I adapt.
Didn't know.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, so having a, you know, doing that business plan, really trying to have that understanding of what those costs are, I think is huge, and then your sales outlets is huge as well. And so also learning about, you know, if you're in college, going and taking a business class, I think that is huge. If you have any desire, I think it should be required that every college student take a business class.
Mm-hmm.
That was not the case 10 years ago when I graduated. but I think everyone should take a business class and really have an understanding about taxes and insurance and that all
yeah.
junk that nobody likes.
All the adult stuff, right?
All of the adult stuff nobody wants to talk about. Mm-hmm. So I, you know, going back, just, if you can have a good understanding of the business side, that'll just set you apart and put you so much farther ahead. So, and even spending like a year, like if you could spend a year prepping your ground and putting in the infrastructure, that'll save you a ton of time. Because if you're trying to do it all, building your website, if you're trying to do it all at the same time, you're going to be very frustrated and be burned out because it's no fun.
Yeah.
So I've been there and I've done that, and it's really no fun trying to do it all. You know, I get up between 3 and 4 o'clock in the morning, 7 days a week, and just so I can work a few hours before my family gets up, and then really just try to prioritize those tasks that I need to focus on before the rest of the world gets up. And so, and then taking time for myself and my family, you know,
exactly.
just those priorities. But it's a lot of hustle and a lot of grunt work for the first 3 to 5 years, I would say. And hopefully after that, it gets a little bit easier. But I think, you know, and I think it's like that with any startup business,
right?
Is any startup business, and you can, one of my favorite podcasts is How I Built This, and I love how he interviews different startup companies, and they're all very similar, but the first 3 to 5 years are the hardest, and you know, that's, there's all the statistics of businesses fail in
yep.
the first 1, 3, and 5 years, and so if you can get it through there, hopefully it'll be better and smooth sailing, so.
Well, Georgia, I want to thank you for your time today. And hopefully once kind of the flower starts to bloom and everything, we'll have a more in-depth tour of all of that as well. But If anybody would like to get in contact with you guys or to keep in touch, what are some good ways for them to do that?
Absolutely. So you can go through our website and send me an email. That's probably the easiest. I am very active on social media, Instagram and Facebook. I love my Instagram stories. We have a little YouTube channel that's a work in progress, Basecamp Farms. Plenty of options. I'm happy to do tours and talk on the phone and, you know, do some phone calls and encouraging coaching calls kind of things as well. We'd love to chat flowers and plants and how to get you started.
Well, thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Hopefully those of you who are listening or watching have learned a lot today. I know I totally have about flowers, things I never knew, and just the whole industry side of it all. So thank you, and stay tuned for hopefully a tour coming soon.